think a lot of the kids are already gone. Some of the kids are heading out. You'll notice that there's been a lot that's changing here in the church. We've got VBS stuff that's happening. Aaron's going to be out there doing some work. I'll be staying after the service today. We've got a leadership meeting, and then I'll be staying, and we'll be doing some work. Yeah, leadership meeting, yeah. And I'll be doing some work, getting some VBS decorations up, because it's only a couple of weeks away. I mean, it really sneaks up on you, and then it's over before you even know it, and you're like, good grief, where did the time go, and why is my back hurting so much? Because it takes a lot out of you. I guess I should, like, be over here instead. What in the world? I think a lot of people have figured out that if you're sitting right here, that means you're on the live feed. Everybody can see your bald spots and all that fun stuff. Not saying you got one, Thomas. But if you had one, it'd be shiny and glimmery up there on Facebook for everybody to see. Do you? I'm sorry. It helps with the lighting. All right, let's get into God's Word this morning. If you would, go ahead and get your Bibles out and turn to 1 Peter chapter 3. That's where we're going to be this morning. 1 Peter chapter 3, looking at verses 13 through 17. But as you're turning there, let me do a little bit of a recap. As we've been looking, this is our final Sunday looking at this sermon series entitled Not Ashamed. Where we've been looking at how we are not ashamed of Jesus Christ. We are not ashamed of His Word. We are not ashamed of His work. And we are not ashamed of the gospel, for the gospel is a revelation of the righteousness of God and the power of God through salvation in Jesus Christ. And if we have Jesus Christ in our hearts, then we will not be put to shame. But we would rejoice and proclaim the gospel, that good news of salvation that comes through Jesus Christ. We've looked at the practical way of doing this and following Jesus Christ, that we are to deny ourselves, take up our cross daily, as it says in Luke. We take up our cross daily and follow after Him. And we are not to be ashamed to speak the name of Jesus Christ, for it is the name of Jesus Christ by which all men are to be saved, all mankind is to be saved. So we are to boldly proclaim the name of Jesus Christ and not be ashamed of it. And today we're going to look at how we are to defend our faith, knowing that those who oppose Jesus Christ and oppose His church, they will be the ones who are put to shame and not us. That we are to be ready when that time comes, that we are to defend our faith using God's word as our defense. So here we are in 1 Peter 3, looking at verses 13 through 17. Now, who is there to harm you if you are zealous for what is good? But even if you should suffer for righteousness' sake, you will be blessed. Have no fear of them, nor be troubled. But in your hearts, honor Christ the Lord as holy, always being prepared to make a defense to anyone who asks you for a reason for the hope that is in you. Yet do it with gentleness and respect, having a good conscience, so that when you are slandered, those who revile your good behavior in Christ may be put to shame. For it is better to suffer for doing good, if that should be God's will, than for doing evil. Let us pray this morning. Heavenly Father, may we come to You with thankfulness in our hearts. May we come to You with our souls fallen on our knees, humbled by the fact that we have Your very word that has now been spoken to us, that has now been breathed out to breathe life into the church, because we know that Your word is alive and it is active. So Lord, may Your Holy Spirit move through the spoken word, that it would instill within our hearts a hope that we have in Jesus Christ, that Your word would be etched upon our hearts, that we'd be ready in any case to give a defense, that we'd be ready in any case to proclaim the name of Jesus Christ, Your Son, in whom we pray. Amen. How is it, there's a question here, how is it that Peter could proclaim this, that no one can do you harm? How is it that Peter can proclaim this with such confidence? That you can go through life as a Christian, being reviled and being persecuted, and find no harm in that. How is it that Peter can speak this, preach this, and now we read this with confidence? It's because we know Peter went through it. You can go to the book of Acts, the Acts of the Apostles, and you can see that there were plenty of times when Peter was with John, or Peter was there with the disciples, the apostles, and he was being accosted, or he was being put in prison, he was arrested, put in prison, or he was beaten, or he was put before a council of Jewish leaders, and they would be there to ask him questions about the faith, to ask him questions about what he is preaching, but more so to say, you're not allowed to do it anymore. You're no longer allowed to speak the name of Jesus Christ, because if you do, we will put you in prison. Ultimately, we will put you to death. But Peter didn't stop. Peter did not stop preaching. It didn't matter what man did to him. Now, we do find instances of harm coming to the apostles, of floggings and beatings, of persecution taking on a physical aspect, that they would be beaten and then thrown into prison. We even see Stephen being stoned, murdered for his faith and his belief. But he stood there before them all with peace, not only in his heart, but he stood there before them all with peace on his face, that they could look upon him, and it was like looking at the face of an angel, that there was peace there even in the midst of the persecution, even with every stone that was being thrown at him. He had peace because, yes, there could be physical harm, but there is nothing that man can do to harm your soul. Nothing. And that's why Peter is saying, don't fear them. He is saying at the beginning of this passage, do not fear them, because we know in Scripture that man can do nothing to the soul. Do not fear man, but instead fear God, who is not only the creator of the soul, but God is the one who, the only one who can destroy a soul. And see, there's nothing that this world can throw at you that can harm your soul in such a way that it would be destroyed. There can be stones thrown at you. There could be words thrown at you. There could even be social harm that's thrown at you, because we find people that are often like that. Well, what is somebody else going to think about me if I proclaim the name of Jesus Christ? Or, man, I'm going to be put in Facebook prison because I post the name of Jesus Christ on my wall, or I say anything against what they're wanting everyone to say. Or, what could happen to me? I could lose all my friends if I speak the name of Jesus Christ. Well, so what? If that's not much of a friend, if they would turn their back on you because you were proclaiming the name of Jesus Christ. He sticks closer than a brother. There's no greater friend than Jesus Christ. It might be physical harm that we might suffer, but they cannot do anything. Maybe emotional harm that we might suffer, but they cannot do anything. It might be social harm that we could suffer, but they cannot do anything to the soul. It will remain unharmed because it is in the hands of God. If you should suffer, he says, you will be blessed. Peter says you will be blessed if you should suffer. I think Peter understood this full well, even to the point of his crucifixion, that Jesus prophesied and predicted in John, in chapter 21 of John, looking at verses 18 through 19. There's a little parenthetical statement that's there when Jesus is talking to John and Peter there. And he's talking about Peter's arms being stretched out wide. And it says there in that parenthetical statement of the book of John, he's helping us to understand, hey, reader, this is Jesus telling you how Peter is going to die. And so brought down through tradition, we have learned that Peter was crucified. But Peter didn't want to, in this moment, didn't want to count himself the same as Jesus Christ, because he felt unworthy to die the same death that Jesus died. Like Peter could look back on his life and think of it with shame because of the denial that we see of the denial of Jesus Christ, when Peter denied Jesus Christ three times. Peter would look back on his life with shame, but he didn't look at Jesus Christ with shame. He didn't look upon his life at that moment with shame, because he knew that he was walking in a newness of life. But he did want to be counted with Christ when it came to suffering, but when it came to his death, he said, no, you will not crucify me in the way that my Savior was crucified. As it's passed down throughout tradition, we find that Peter was crucified upside down. And that prophecy that Jesus spoke of in John chapter 21, we do find that later, as it is written throughout tradition, that Peter was crucified for his belief. He did suffer. We follow that suffering through the book of Acts. Peter knew that he would be persecuted because Jesus told him and the other disciples that it would be so. We read about that in Luke chapter 21. That's not the only portion of Scripture where we see Jesus predicting the persecution, the trials, and the tribulations that the disciples must go through. But I'm going to read for you this morning Luke 21, 12. And Jesus says to the disciples, "But before all this, they will lay their hands on you and persecute you, delivering you up to the synagogues and prisons. And you will be brought before kings and governors for my name's sake." And so for Peter, it should not have come as a surprise, as he is out there proclaiming and he's building the church. And he's proclaiming the name of Jesus Christ, that there would be those that would oppose him. There would be those that would stand up against him. But he found blessing in that moment. How would it be a blessing to be persecuted? We would ask that question. How would Peter look at it this way, in a different perspective, to see persecution and suffering as a blessing? It's because Jesus told him that it would be that way. So not only do we have that portion of Luke chapter 21 where he says you're going to be persecuted, but we can go back further to Matthew chapter 5, the Sermon on the Mount, and we can see there in the Beatitudes, this wonderful nugget of wisdom and prophecy, as Jesus speaks about the persecution that must take place. In Matthew 5, beginning in verse 11, he says, "Blessed are you," and he's talking to the disciples here, "blessed are you when others revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account." Falsely. That's a very important word because Peter talks about slander. But when people speak falsely against you on my account, on the account of Jesus, and here's what Jesus says that they are to do in this moment when there's persecution, when there's those that revile you. He says, "Rejoice. Rejoice and be glad. For your reward is great in heaven. For so they persecuted the prophets who were before you." See, Peter was able to see blessings as a result of persecution because he was counted with Christ in the midst of the persecution. That's why in the book of Acts, when the disciples are there before the Jewish councils, or they're thrown in prison and they're brought back to the church and the believers, they're brought back together with their brothers and sisters in Christ, they rejoice for the persecution that they went to because it meant that they were included in the persecution of Jesus Christ. And so when Peter was beaten and flogged and thrown in prison, it wasn't just Peter, and it wasn't just John, and it wasn't just Paul, and it wasn't just Barnabas, and it wasn't just Silas, but those people were beating and persecuting Jesus Christ at that time too. He felt that persecution as his children were going through it. And the fact that they were included in what Jesus went through also. And we find on multiple occasions that Peter and the other disciples, the apostles, they had to defend their faith. That they were being pressured and they were being put into a corner and they were being told, "No, you cannot speak this name anymore." And Peter says, "I can't help but speak the name of Jesus Christ and the wonderful things that he has done for me. I can't help but proclaim." We find Peter encouraging believers to continue in this way, knowing that persecution will continue to happen. And Christians will continually have to defend their faith. He tells us here in this epistle, in this letter to the church, he tells us that in our hearts we must honor God. We must honor Christ. And how do we do this? How do we honor Christ, church? One way in particular that I know of is we stay in his word. Not just once a week. Not just for about 20 minutes when the pastor is preaching on a Sunday morning. And some of you are like, 20 minutes? Not just once a week, but every day. Every new gift of a day that God gives to you, you go to God's word. And here's what you'll find. You'll begin to look at things completely differently in light of Scripture. If Scripture, if God's Word, the truth and the only truth is the light of your life, then you will start looking at things a lot differently. You will no longer look at the world in the lens of the flesh, but you will begin to look at the world through the lens of Scripture, and things will start looking a lot differently. Your perception of life will completely change. Your perception of every new day will completely change when God's Word is what leads you and guides you. And when you put God's Word upon yourself, there is nothing that the evil one, there is nothing that the devil can throw at you. It cannot penetrate through the truth. The lies of the world, the lies of the flesh, and golly, this world is sucked up into lies right now. They would rather listen to the lies than they'd rather believe the lies of the flesh and of the world and of the devil, the ruler of this world, than to turn to the actual truth, because we know that that truth shines a light into the darkest corners of every heart. And those who cling to the flesh, those who cling to the world, fight that light like cockroaches in a nasty kitchen. As soon as you turn that light on, they go scurrying to the darkness and the shadows because they love darkness more than they love the light. We learn about that in John chapter 1. When the light of God entered into the world, when the light of the world entered into the world, who is now in us. See, we, with the light in us and the Word of God living in us, we have a hope. One of the biggest promises that we have as Christians is that we are saved not only from sin, but also saved from death, and that there is no one in this world or any other world that can separate us from the love of God. And that one day we will see Jesus face to face. So within every Christian, there is that hope. Within every true believer, there is that hope, a living hope. It is a hope that is alive. Peter talks about this in the first chapter of this letter. In 1 Peter 1, verses 3 through 9, he talks about those who are born again into a living hope. That hope is Jesus Christ, who is alive in us today. But the world, we look at the opposites. We can look at the unbelievers, and we look at true believers. We look at those who are of Christ and those who are of the world, and we find that those who are of the world remain in a perpetual state of hopelessness. And that's why we have unborn babies being killed at an outrageous number every single day. That's why we have mass shootings in classrooms and in schools. It's because there's no longer hope in the schools. There's no longer hope in the people that are clinging on to this world. And so that's why they cling on to the next big thing and the next shiny thing. That's why they cling on to the next big and bold and shiny politician. They put their hope in the things of man. They put their hope in the politicians. They put their hope in this world. And that's why they get so uptight and so worried about the global warming and all this nonsense. Because they have no hope in the things that are eternal, but the things that are passing away. And they hold on to it and cling to it because that's their only hope. And we find that it is really no hope at all. But for Christians on this side, for those that have a living hope within them, we hope in the things that are eternal. We hope in the things that will never pass away. We hope in the Creator of this world, who has brought us into a new creation, who is going to make for us a new world, a new heaven and a new earth where we will be in the glory of God. That is what we hope in. We have hope in Jesus Christ that one day we will see Him face to face. And we don't place our hope in man. We don't place our hope in the things of the flesh. We don't place our hope in this world because there's nothing going to be left of this world. The only thing that's going to continue is the truth, and that is God's Word. And so for our souls that are eternal, we have hope within us that is alive, and it is Jesus Christ. And there might be a day when people will come to you and ask about this hope that is implanted in you. And if you have the Word of God in your heart, then you are ready. If you have taken upon yourself the word of God, then you will be ready in any case, ready to defend your faith against the world and the ruler of darkness. And there will be people who will want to snuff out that hope. Oh, they want to know where that hope comes from. And in that moment, we must be ready. Paul tells us in Ephesians chapter 6 that we must be suited in armor. And he doesn't say, just put on one piece of armor. He doesn't say, just put on the belt. He doesn't say, just put on the helmet. He doesn't say, you'll be just fine with only a breastplate. He says, he doesn't say all you need is a shield. No, what Paul says in Ephesians chapter 6 is put on the whole armor of God. Put on all of it. Not just one piece, not just a couple of pieces, but put on all of it. You put on the whole armor of God and you are ready to face anything that the world or the flesh or Satan can throw at you. And here's what Paul says in Ephesians 6, you put on the belt of truth. And we turn to John chapter 14 and we find that Jesus is the way. Jesus is the truth. Jesus is the life. Jesus is who is the Word of God, is the truth. And so we put on the belt of truth. And he begins with the belt of truth because it's what holds everything up. If I didn't have my belt on right now, I'd be in trouble. And it would not be pretty. And that probably makes some people jealous, but we're not going to go there. The breastplate of righteousness. The breastplate of righteousness. The righteousness of God, as Paul tells us in Romans chapter 1, the righteousness of God is revealed in His Word. So we put on the belt of truth. We put on the breastplate of righteousness. And then Paul talks about in Ephesians chapter 6, the shoes of the readiness of the gospel. In Luke chapter 4, Jesus tells us that it is God's word that reveals to us the gospel, that reveals to us the good news. And Paul doesn't stop there. Put on the belt of truth, put on the breastplate of righteousness, put on the shoes of the readiness of the gospel, and then pick up and carry the shield of faith. Faith that comes through hearing and hearing through God's what? Word. As Paul tells us in Romans chapter 10. And then we have the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. Every piece of the whole armor of God points us back to what, church? His Word. And so if we put His Word upon us like armor, and we don that armor just like people did in the Middle Ages and they were fighting and all that, they wore it in order to defend themselves from the enemy's attack. They didn't wear it for offense. They wore it to protect their vital organs and their appendages, make sure that their arms and their chest were going to be protected. Otherwise, they would die under the attack of the enemy. But we put on the armor, the whole armor of God, which is God's Word, and it protects us. It is God's Word that is our defense. God is our defender. Psalm 18:2, the Lord is my rock and my fortress and my deliverer, my God, my rock in whom I take refuge, my shield and the horn of my salvation. He is my stronghold. And Peter was able to defend his faith with boldness because he and those around him prayed for the boldness. In Acts chapter 4, verse 29, we see that we must do the same. We pray for each other, and I would ask that you would pray for me as I pray for you, that we would go into this dark world and proclaim the name of Jesus Christ boldly. Every day putting on the whole armor of God, ready for any attack that might come to us. Also, we find that Peter was given instruction on what to do when faced with persecution. He was given instruction by the great teacher of all, and that is Jesus Christ, the greatest teacher of all. So what is it, Peter, that you must do? What is it that Jesus taught you? We find that in Matthew chapter 10, looking at verses 19 and 20. And this is what he says to the disciples, when they deliver you over, just like it was saying in Luke 21, when they deliver you over, not if, but when they deliver you over, do not be anxious how you are to speak or what you are to say. For what you are to say will be given to you in that hour. For it is not you who speak, but the Spirit of your Father speaking through you. Here's what it looks like for us today, church. Imagine what it would be like to have the greatest defense in any criminal trial. The greatest lawyer who is ever worth his salt, that has your back. And then also imagine that you got the judge on your side too. And there's no way that you could lose. Because the one who stands in our defense is Jesus Christ. The one who stands who stands for the judgment that we deserve, he was given. That we stand before the great judge that is God the Father, and we stand before God the Father innocent. As his mercy and his grace is poured out on us through the blood of Jesus Christ. Now imagine every day of your life walking the face of this earth, and you've got the greatest defense around you, behind you, beside you, and before you. What would that greatest defense look like? You get up in the morning and you turn to God's word. Every night before you go to bed, you go to God's word. You get up the next morning, your first focus is the word of God. Before you lay your head down at night, your main focus is the word of God. And you've got the word of God that is being poured into your heart and poured into your life, that whenever someone stands up against you and speaks falsely against you, you've got the word of God at your defense. The greatest defense that we have. There is no lie, there is no empty claim that the world or man can throw at you, because you have the defense of God's word, not only as a shield, but also as a sword. Ready to protect yourself. Because the lies that they would speak about the church today, they have no foundation in truth. The lies that the world speaks about the church today, even the politicians that are in this country, the lies that they speak about the church today have no grounding in truth at all. And it is ridiculous what is being said. But they will be the ones that are put to shame, and it's not our job to do it. Because what you read right here in this passage from Peter is that God is the one who puts them to shame. What we do is we live peaceful lives with a living hope that is within us, that we stand against those stones being thrown at the church with peace in our hearts and faces like that of angels, as Stephen stood there in that way. Because we have a hope that is greater than this world. So when they speak against the church, know that they will be the ones that are put to shame. People will say whatever they can to destroy the hope that is in you, but God's word is more powerful than anything that this world could say. Peter gives us a proverb to close out this passage, a golden nugget of wisdom from a man who walked with Christ, who preached the name of Christ before his enemies, a word of wisdom from a man who was persecuted, went through thick and thin, but he continued to do what was right. He was human. We don't look to him as a picture of morality, but we look to him as an example of being ready to defend our faith. Peter says, if we are to suffer, let it be for what is good in the sight of God. It is better to suffer for doing good than to suffer for doing evil. Because the suffering for doing good is momentary. And the suffering for doing good brings about an award, a reward. You can look to Peter, you can look to Paul, you can look to James, you can look to John to see men who suffered for the sake of righteousness. Looking at Peter, looking at Paul, and looking at James, here's what they say about it. James says, consider it pure joy when you face trials of various kinds. That the testing of your faith brings steadfastness, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking nothing. James 1, verses 2 through 4. And then we look at Paul, who is no stranger to suffering. And Paul says that we rejoice in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. Romans chapter 5, verses 3 through 5. And then we can look at Peter. Once again, a man who was no stranger to persecution. And he says, and after you have suffered a little while, the God of all grace, who has called you to his eternal glory in Christ, will himself restore, confirm, strengthen, and establish you. Peter writes about that in 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 10. These are three men who died for their faith, who were not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And they were not put to shame, but they are in glory today. I'm going to ask the team to come up, that they would sing one more song. And what I want to do in this moment, not to look at James or to Paul or to Peter, but to look to Jesus Christ instead. And we find great words of comfort and wisdom from Jesus in John chapter 16, verse 33. And this is a proclamation over all believers, over all of those who have the living hope of Jesus Christ in their hearts. Jesus says, I have said these things to you, that in me you have peace. In the world you will have tribulation, but take heart, I have overcome the world. I'm going to ask that we would bow your heads and close your eyes, that we may go to the Lord in a state of reverent prayer, in reflecting on what Peter has written in this letter to the church, of what he has written to us today. But more importantly, this is God's word speaking to his church. Oh, to be counted with Christ. And what rejoicing that we should be considered to be one with him. That others would hate us, and we rejoice knowing that Jesus was hated by the world first. That the world would reject us, knowing that he, Jesus Christ, was the cornerstone that the builders rejected. He has overcome the world. And now we are here as children of God, worshiping him in light of what he has done for us. Knowing that he has overcome the world, he is our world. He is our everything. Because he has given us everything through his Son. And we have peace in him even in these dark days. He is guiding our every step so that we too shall overcome this world. Thank you. Peter is encouraging the church, and so I too encourage you, church, to be ready to defend your faith, knowing that persecution will continue until that day. Until that day comes when Jesus returns to trample the enemies underneath our feet. Be reminded of Peter's words as they mirror the words of Christ. And in closing, the words of Christ that he spoke in Matthew chapter 5, "Blessed are you when others revile you, and blessed are you when you are persecuted and others speak all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice, church. Rejoice, child of God, and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven." Your reward is in heaven, and I'm just happy to say my reward is heaven. Because that's where all striving will cease, in the presence of my Savior. Together, may we sing one more song of how great God is, that he has brought us through so much, and he continues to do so much more for us every single day. I would ask that you would pray there, and if you need someone to pray with, I will be right up here. And if you don't know what to pray, allow the Spirit of God to pray on your behalf. Allow this song to be a prayer this morning.